Welcome, LA Progressive friends and family. I'm really excited to have a woman joining me today whose book I purchased several years ago and was just so moved. I have with me today Daria Roithmayr, and she wrote Reproducing Racism: How Everyday Choices Lock in White Advantage. And of all the books I've read, and there have been scores, I really appreciated her approach because she tackles this issue from a legal perspective, specifically from monopoly antitrust lens. And I just think it fits so well. So, Daria, welcome. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me. I'm really thrilled to be here.
So, when I read your book, I thought, oh, this book needs to be required reading at least at the high school level, even at the junior high school level, because our country is just so divided, and it's divided partly along the racial divide. It's divided partly because of a lack of understanding. And I think this book really provides a depth of knowledge that's just so lacking. So to begin with, talk to me about why it is that you use monopolies and antitrust law to explain how these cartels exist.
Well, let me start by saying thank you for your comment about required reading, and also for your comment about the lack of understanding and the way in which that contributes to division, because that's very much my view and one of the reasons I wrote the book. And the more specific reason for why I chose the approach that I did actually has to do with a very fortuitous event. I went to visit a friend of mine and we trade books. And I was leaving and she didn't have a book for me. So she said, "Let's go raid my husband's night table." And on the top of her husband's stack was a book called Complexity. And it had a great looking cover. So I grabbed it and brought it with me to read on the plane. And it was a book about something called complex systems theory. And the opening story was about an economist named Brian Arthur, who had articulated an argument about monopolies, in particular about Microsoft, that laid out the argument that I eventually draw on in the book, which is for certain kinds of markets, there is a different kind of dynamic than the kind of dynamic that we think usually governs markets. And that is, in digital and tech markets, those that have get more. So early popularity translates into later popularity. And that a lot of the tech monopolists that he was looking at had taken advantage of this snowballing dynamic so that their advantage became self-reinforcing over time, even in the absence of doing anything more innovative. Just by being popular, the operating system or the digital platform was able to become the market leader and to lock out any other competitor because of these self-reinforcing advantages. And as I read, I thought to myself, this is the answer to this problem that I've been wrestling with, which was to articulate the way in which structural racism had both reproduced itself over time in this self-reinforcing way. It's the Billie Holiday song, "Them that's got shall get, them that's not shall lose," right?
Absolutely. That's what I was going to
Right?
suggest. That should
It's
have
not
that.
what you know, it's who you know. And all of the other sayings that we know intuitively explain why people are in power. And why other people can't seem to catch a break no matter what. And so I very quickly became an expert in antitrust law. It actually took quite a while. And I did a lot of work familiarizing myself with this complex systems theory concept of self-reproducing advantage. And it fits so perfectly with what I had been thinking about in my critical race theory scholarship. And so that's the story of how the argument came to be.
Interesting. So when I introduced you, I did not mention that at the time that I purchased the book, I believe that you were a law professor at USC at that time.
Yes.
And now you are still a law professor at the University of Colorado?
Yes. Yes. I moved last fall.
And you just mentioned critical race theory. What area of law do you teach?
So my main identity is that I teach and write in the area of critical race theory. And I write in particular about persistent racial inequality that reproduces itself over time. And more recently, I've been doing a lot of work and teaching on racial capitalism. And that's what my new book is about, which I'm hoping we'll have a chance to chat about a little later. But
I can't wait. Can't wait to get my hands on that.
I'm a critical race theorist whose focus is on structural racism. And so that's mainly what I write and teach. I also teach constitutional law, and I teach a little bit about legislation and regulation as well. So I wear several hats in my teaching, but my scholarship is focused on critical race theory.
So I'm always interested when someone writes on the issues of race, what did their lived experience, how did their lived experience help them to be open even to delving into this topic? And can you tell me a little bit about your personal lived experience and how that prepared you for this?
Absolutely. So as we were talking about before we began the recording, I'm Latina. My mother is Mexican, and I grew up in Mississippi in the 60s. So on the Gulf Coast. And so between my experience as the daughter of a Latina and as a 17-year resident of Southern Mississippi, I was more aware than many in other parts of the country of the way in which race just seemed to be hardwired or baked into the scaffolding of political, social, and economic life. And the way in which, especially in Southern Mississippi, where African Americans were in the majority in my town and in the slight minority in the sister town, regardless of numbers and capacity for voting, the same people were in power, the same people held on to the reins of power. And a lot of that power was structural. It seemed to operate behind the scenes in a hidden way, even in the absence of any evidence, especially in the modern era, that intentional discrimination was going on. And for me, the key problem for us to address as progressives was not the fact that African Americans and Latinos get followed in department stores, although that is a very important problem to address, but rather the wealth disparity, the employment disparity, the infant mortality disparity, the housing disparity, the education disparity, these structural disparities that people have taken for granted as a product of culture or the lack of education. That was where I wanted to focus my lens, because I saw the operation of that kind of structural disparity very much in my hometown. And then later when I moved to both Washington, D.C. and Los Angeles, I saw that residential segregation as really the focus of a lot of this self-reinforcing energy that I was beginning to think about.
Absolutely. I know that for me personally, when I looked at, you know, as I grew up, you know, I was raised to believe, well, you know, the same old mantra, you know, if you work hard, if you're educated, everything will work out okay for you. But as I did all those things and still found myself hitting a brick wall, and then as I stepped back and objectively looked at my community and found that in all of the areas that measure human well-being, whether we're talking about healthcare or education or housing or wealth, in all of those areas, we're at the lower end, at the bottom. And when I read your book, the one message that came so clear to me, that's why I think, you know, everybody should have this knowledge, is having this knowledge as a Black child or as a brown child is really empowering and can give you a sense of agency, because there is a tendency to believe that we're at the lower end because of some deficiency within ourselves, as opposed to the things that you talk about, these four different types of feedback loops. You want to talk about the four different types of feedback loops?
Well, so I can talk about them generally, but before I do that, I want to say that I think it's no coincidence you said there's this tendency to believe. It's not just a tendency, right? It's that's what power wants you to believe.
That's right.
This is not the self-reinforcing advantage that came about because of Jim Crow and slavery. This is a cultural deficiency. This is Daniel Moynihan's poverty of the Black family and the absence of fathers. That's what's really going on. If you listen to Capital, if you listen to Power, if you listen to conservatives. And so I do think of this project as having taken the veneer of cultural deficiency off to show that this isn't really about cultural deficiency. This isn't to focus the lens on those who are trapped by self-reinforcing inequality. It's to focus the lens on those who are reinforcing the inequality. Having said that, I will say that one of the contributions that the book makes is to show the ways in which even well-meaning, sometimes even progressive whites contribute to self-reinforcing inequality just by making the everyday choices that we all make, whether it's choosing to refer a friend for a job. Statistically speaking, you're more likely to be referring someone of your race. And if you're wealthy, you're going to be referring them to a high-wage job with an opportunity for advancement. Or deciding where to send your kids to school and where to buy a home. So some of the most progressive people I know draw the line when it comes to sending their kids to public schools. Barack Obama and Bill Clinton both sent their kids to Sidwell Friends in Washington, D.C., even as they were proclaiming that they were supporters of public education. And so that's not to call those decisions racist, but rather to point out that the problem is at the systemic level, not at the level of individual choice. No one expects people who have privilege and opportunity to send their children to schools that are underfinanced. We all acknowledge that the education system is broken, but figuring out why it's broken, why money goes to the suburban schools of Los Angeles, to Palos Verdes, and not to the public schools in Roland Heights, that really is part of the analysis. So the feedback loops that I describe, I think it's probably easier just to describe one feedback loop to give you some sense of the way this works. So, and this is one that we're all familiar with and one that I was just talking about in terms of education. So owing to racial discrimination, very much to residential segregation, which was legal until 1948, when the Supreme Court issued some key decisions, and then really until in the 70s and 80s, when they started trying to enforce Title VIII of the Civil Rights Act. Residential segregation means that you concentrate racialized wealth into different pockets. So wealthy white neighborhoods concentrate a lot of wealth and social networks where people have good jobs with high wages and opportunities for advancement. and segregated poor Black neighborhoods, like the neighborhoods of the South Side in Chicago, concentrate racialized poverty. And the reason that people of color are poor can be traced to intentional discrimination when it comes to being hired, and then lots of discrimination having to do with banks and wealth that Mirza Baradaran writes about. And so to think of these concentrated pockets of race and wealth or race and poverty then translates into what the public schools look like, right? So segregated public schools in Roland Heights or East LA in the LA Unified School District are underfinanced by far relative to the Palos Verde schools, where they actually require parents to volunteer one day a week and have PTA slush funds that are upwards of $1 million. And these are the structural results of choosing to finance schools, either, as many states do, using property taxes, or in Los Angeles, through a central pot of money that nevertheless can be supplemented by parental wealth in the form of PTA slush funds. And so the kids who graduate from those schools will go on to have very different opportunities. Kids who attend Palos Verde schools are being trained on state-of-the-art cutting-edge technology with lots of wealthy folks in their professional and personal networks. Kids who are graduating from East LA public schools are having trouble being able to read at grade level, in large part because of the difficulty of hiring schools, hiring teachers at relatively lower salaries, and difficulty just even sometimes getting textbooks. I taught high school in Mississippi for 3 years before I went to law school, so I know firsthand the difficulties that public schools can run into when they're dealing with a relatively lower tax base or financial base. So those kids are going to graduate and take low wage jobs with little opportunity for advancement. Those Palos Verdes kids are going to grow up to take much higher wage jobs with a lot more opportunity for advancement. And then they're going to be able to move into wealthy neighborhoods where their kids are going to attend well-financed public schools. And kids who graduate, if they graduate at all, for Latinos, that's especially an issue, won't be able to move into those neighborhoods. And in fact, will often be priced out of their own neighborhoods as those neighborhoods gentrify. So you can see the operation of these feedback loops over time, even in the absence of ongoing discrimination. So if intentional discrimination were to end tomorrow, but people didn't do anything about the way that public schools were financed or anything to dismantle residential segregation, which in Los Angeles is among the most segregated in the country, then those inequalities will continue in the absence of some major government intervention.
Yeah, you know, so many people, they don't seem to get this. Now, I've heard you give an example. You talk about how Microsoft was engaged in bad behavior, and that bad behavior really put them at a significant advantage over other companies. And so then they stop the bad behavior.
Exactly.
But they still have this advantage.
Right. And the advantage grew. It snowballed.
Yes.
And when the Department of Justice came to them and said, they said, we're not doing anything anymore. We're not engaging in bad behavior. We stopped. This is, you know, nothing to do with us. And this is where Brian Arthur really made his mark. He said, wait a minute. Let's look at why you were more popular of an operating system than the other operating systems that you pushed out of the market. And even after you stopped, the fact that you were popular meant that more software authors were going to write for you. And the more software authors that wrote for your operating system, the more customers were going to buy your operating system, which meant more software authors, which meant more customers, and so on.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, just the book is just fabulous. Now, you say that you're working on another book. And I just can't wait for the, when is that going to come out?
I'm doing a book proposal right now, so it's very early stages. But
Okay.
I published a paper on it already. The title of the book provisionally is Racism Pays, How Innovations Get Off the Ground by Relying on Racial Exploitation. And the book essentially points out that some of our most high-profile innovations in the digital economy were only able to get off the ground because innovators like Apple and Amazon and Uber racially exploited workers of color, underpaying them, giving them no health insurance, sick leave, overtime, or retirement. In many instances, paying them so little that they couldn't even break even, and nevertheless profiting immensely. You know, Jeff Bezos is among the richest people in the world, profiting off of this group of workers of color who have been in many ways responsible for the success of these innovations. So you may be aware that in Los Angeles, over 80% of Uber and Lyft drivers are people of color or immigrants. That's no accident. The reason that that's true is because those jobs pay so little that the only people who will take those jobs are people who have fewer outside options. And so the argument rests on the idea that workers of color can be racially exploited because they don't have the same outside options. If they get a job referral, then they're less likely to be hired. They're less likely to get a job referral for reasons that get explained in that first book. They're less likely to have people in their professional and personal networks, people they went to school with, friends of parents, who have access to high wage, high opportunity jobs. And then once they're in those jobs, they're far less likely to quit, even when their wages are cut in half, because they don't have the kind of wealth they need to fall back on while they wait for another opportunity. You know, people with advantage can be between jobs for a while, resting on their savings or other forms of wealth. People who live paycheck to paycheck can't make the same kinds of decisions. And so these are the workers who innovators depend on to create an elastic, almost nameless workforce that they can hire at a moment's notice, that they can fire at a moment's notice, that they can make, supply their own health insurance, sick leave, et cetera. And we really saw the effect of that during COVID in terms of who was getting sick, who was bringing the virus home to their families. Uber drivers were essential workers, and they didn't really have the choice whether or not to work. They had to work because they were living paycheck to paycheck. And the book really focuses on those innovators to show that racial exploitation isn't just a thing of the past. It didn't end with slavery and the end of Jim Crow. And so the book explores some ways to try to think about how to solve that problem. But it really is focused on describing the idea that racial exploitation didn't end. And we see it in these very high profile innovations.
Yes. You're absolutely right. My husband, Dick Price, is a white man, for those of you who don't know us. And when in our early years of marriage, one of the biggest arguments, or the recurring arguments we would have, is he felt that things were improving from a racial standpoint, and I just wasn't so sure. And now we don't have that argument anymore.
Now it's clear even to Dick, right?
Yeah, it's clear even to Dick. He's been married to me long enough. He's seen enough examples that, no, it's really not getting better. And, you know, and I just remind him, you know, we had Brown v. Board of Education in 1954. Now look at the public school system. Is it any better?
Right.
It is just as racially divided and segregated.
Right.
Because while we no longer have state-sanctioned segregation, we have socially sanctioned, supported, endorsed segregation, even among white progressives.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And so if you ask many people, why is it that so many of the Uber and Lyft drivers are people of color, they'll say, well, that's what they want. And they like having the flexibility instead of really looking at the structural forces that trap them in those jobs, but offers ways out for white workers.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, I think we've reached the limits of our time, and I hope that we will be coming together again when your next book comes out, because I just
I would
can't
love to.
wait. Thank you
That would
so
be great.
much. Thank you so
you.
much. Thank you for the work that you do. And I just wish you the best of fortune. I hope that this book, even though it was written many years ago, we need it now, I think, more than ever.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And those viewers who want to buy the book can buy it on independent book sites like Powell's, but they can also buy it on Amazon as well.
Yeah, I know.
Notwithstanding what I just said about Amazon.
I know. We need to have a discussion about how do you live in capitalist society
right.
and not be a part of it. It's almost
right.
impossible.
Yeah. Well, I would answer that just very briefly by saying, don't fool yourself that those individual choices are going to make a difference when the problem is much higher at the structural and population level. You're
Thank you.
you're trapped in making those choices
Yes.
because you can't break out. There's no alternative.
Right. Well, Daria Roithmayr, thank you for spending some time with the LA Progressive, and we look forward to seeing you again sometime in the near future.
And thank you so much for the work that LA Progressive does. It keeps the progressive vision alive, which is no small accomplishment in this day and age. So right back at you.
Thank you. So long. Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.